copies so you didn't get a card. I don't want many. On behalf of Effie's family, thank you all for coming today to spend this time with her family, to remember the life that the Lord gave her, the life that the person that she was, a special person to this group in front of us. I'm thankful that you are here to show your support, your love, and your encouragement on this day. I'm going to read from a few different passages as our call to worship, our invitation come before God on this special day, this solemn day, as we are confronted again with the realities of life and death. From Matthew chapter 11, these words from Jesus: "Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." And that familiar verses from John chapter 3. "For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him." And from John chapter 6. Again, the words of Jesus Christ. "Then Jesus declared, I am the bread of life. The one who comes to me will never go hungry. The one who believes in me will never be thirsty. But as I told you, you have seen me and still you do not believe. All that the Father gives me will come to me, and whoever comes to me I will never drive away. For I have come down from heaven not to do my will, but to do the will of the one who sent me. And this is the will of him who sent me, that I shall lose none of all that he has given me, but raise them up on the last day. For my Father's will is that everyone who looks to the Son and believes in him, they shall have eternal life, and I will raise them up on the last day." Words, I hope, will give us hope. These are the promises that God has extended to all of us. It's up to us then to grasp hold of those promises and find true joy and true hope in the words of God. Let's bow our heads in a time of prayer. Faithful God, in your wisdom, you have called your servant and child, Effie, out of this world and into your presence. Though our hearts are feeling grief, we place her in your loving arms. She has been released from the bonds of sin and death, and the old order of things has passed away for her. May we take comfort in knowing that Effie's faith in the Lord Jesus Christ has been fulfilled and has been turned to sight. May Effie's family and friends take solace and peace, knowing that you have received her into your heavenly kingdom, where there is no sorrow, no weeping, no pain, and certainly no death. You have called Effie home, and we surrender her into your arms of love, so that she can now experience the fullness of eternal joy and peace. She is with you, Triune God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And I pray, Lord, that you would be especially with Effie's family and with all of us as we spend this time together worshiping you for the life that you gave Effie. And go with us from this day, being our ever-present help and refuge, as you were to Effie throughout her life. Lord, I pray this on our behalf in Jesus' name. Amen. First song that we're going to sing, you can remain seated for, is "What a Friend We Have in Jesus."
What a privilege.
Now turn to Revelation chapter 21, picture of what is to come. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride, beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "Now the dwelling of God is with mankind, and he will live with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death, or mourning, or crying, or pain, for the old order of things has passed away." He who was seated on the throne said, "Behold, I am making everything new." Then he said, "Write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true." In Effie's final moments of her life here on earth, many of her family were able to be by her side. And as she passed, they noticed she had one tear coming down her cheek. We praise the Lord that Effie will shed no more tears. The Lord's promises here in Revelation 21, they have been fulfilled for Effie. Her assurance was in her Savior, Jesus. And we can trust and know because of her faith, the Lord has welcomed her home. Again, we can remain seated as we sing, "Blessed Assurance."
This is my story. This is my
point, I'm going to invite Crystal up, Effie's granddaughter. Give us some remembrances of Effie. Yep. And after that, we'll watch a short video slideshow of some of the events and times that the family has spent with Effie over the years.
Okay, so today we say goodbye to one of the kindest, most influential people in our lives. Sundays growing up were spent at my grandma's house, where we would all come together as a family for supper. While the adults visited upstairs in the kitchen, us kids would play in the basement, jumping on grandpa's couch, oh, I hated that, and running up and down the hallway. We were always eating grandma's freshly made buns with Dutch cheese and ham while we waited for the raccoons to start. As a kid, I practically grew up at her house. I would get off at the bus at 4 p.m., or like clockwork. She'd have a cup of hot tea ready with one cube of sugar and fresh cream. We spent hours in her garden where I helped her pick weeds. She tried desperately to teach me about gardening. Turns out the only thing I learned was how to eat strawberries, and the secret behind a good salad was Miracle Whip. Her kitchen was always so hot, but it always smelled so good because she was either canning, baking, or cooking. She made the world's best buns and meatball soup and practically lived in all her many aprons. Her aprons also contained hidden candy, which consisted of pink and green peppermints. The white peppermints were only meant for church. Every evening, we would go for a walk to the beehives around the corner, checking all the crops my dad had seeded, watching them grow and eventually get harvested. I learned this as an adult, that that's a mile out and back, so even at a young age, she was teaching me the importance of fitness. When it wasn't windy, she was riding her bike, the one that had a basket in the front and a back seat for me on the back. Grandma loved to sing, and you would often hear her singing to her chickens as she gathered eggs. She loved being a part of the church choir, and I'll never forget how strong and confident she looked in her blue blazer with her matching skirt, her blouse, her shoes, and her scarf, all right out of a page from the Sears catalog. Every Saturday afternoon, we would go to my Auntie Rhonda's and my Auntie Alice's house where she would get her hair done. She sure loved her hair. I would get to play with my cousins Randy, Katie, Teresa, Julie, and Jennifer, and Rebecca. David and Anna were just little babies back then, but Grandma would hold them and show them to us like it was her prized possession. She sure loved her kids, her grandkids, her great-grandkids. She always let us know by giving us the biggest Grandma hugs. In fact, Grandma loved everyone without judgment. She believed that everyone, no matter their misdeeds, was worth saving, and she prayed for our entire family every night. She loved God, and she made it her life's mission to talk to all of us about Jesus. Every opportunity she had was reading to the Bible to us and preaching his word for all of us to hear. She was a remarkable woman who was loved greatly by her family, and even though she is gone, her memory will live in all of us forever.
Thank you. Now we'll watch a short video slideshow. As Crystal mentioned, Effie would often be in her Bible reading. When we looked at her many Bibles, there was many place marks. We had a hard time deciding what we should read here, didn't we, Rhonda? And same with the songs. We're only singing six, but we could have sung a lot more. This is in honor of Effie and her joy of reading God's word and singing praises to him that we gather here today. Our next passage, our scripture passage, comes from Psalm 90. Lord, you have been our dwelling place throughout all generations. Before the mountains were born, for you brought forth the earth and the world. From everlasting to everlasting, you are God. You turn men back to dust, saying, return to dust, O sons of men. For 1,000 years in your sight are like a day that has just gone by, or like a watch in the night. You sweep men away in the sleep of death. They are like the new grass of the morning, though in the morning it springs up new. By evening it is dry and withered. We are consumed by your anger, terrified by your indignation. You have set our iniquities before us, before you, our secret sins in the light of your presence. All our days pass away under your wrath. We finish our years with a moan. The length of our days is 70 years, or 80 if we have the strength. Yet their span is but trouble and sorrow, for they quickly pass and we fly away. Who knows the power of your anger? For your wrath is as great as the fear that is due you. So teach us to number our days aright, that we may gain a heart of wisdom. Relent, O Lord, how long will it be? Have compassion on your servants. Satisfy us in the morning with your unfailing love, that we may sing for joy and be glad all our days. Make us glad for as many days as you have afflicted us, for as many years as we have seen trouble. May your deeds be shown to your servants, your splendor to their children. May the favor of the Lord our God rest upon us. Establish the work of our hands for us. Yes, establish the work of our hands. Psalm, pretty stark in the middle. It describes for us the reality that God is good. We are not always so good. We are sinners, deserving of God's wrath. And yet it ends with a plea that God would relent and have compassion on us. He has done that in the Lord Jesus Christ by sending his Son to earth. And if we're turned to Jesus in faith, we will find peace for our souls. Let's stand together when the music plays and let's sing "When Peace Like a River."
Peace like a river.
Now we turn to Romans chapter 5, where I'll read for us the first five verses. Therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace in which we now stand. And we rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. Not only so, but we also rejoice in our sufferings, because we know that suffering produces perseverance, perseverance, character, and character, hope. And hope does not disappoint us, because God has poured out his love into our hearts by the Holy Spirit, whom he has given us. I came across this saying that I'll share with you in just a moment. I tried to track down who said it first, but I couldn't. I noticed there's a number of books that use it as part of the title. Even Tiger Woods used this line when he was sharing his insights on how to excel in an endeavor like playing golf to his level. Many people have written self-help blog posts and articles about being better, not bitter. Let me say that again. The line is, be better, not bitter. The line has caught the attention of many ministers, like it did for me. Become better, not bitter. That has to do with how we deal with the events of life, particularly how we deal with the struggles, and the trials, and the suffering that we face in life. It makes no difference who we are, where we come from, our ethnicity, our ancestry. We all face adversity, strife, and toil in life. No one is immune to facing hard times and difficult circumstances. In every event that we face, good or bad, but especially the bad and the negative ones, it shapes our character. How we deal with the hard stuff of life, that does determine if we grow better or if we grow bitter. Our perspective while facing hard times and hard circumstances, it determines the outcome. How our character changes depends on what our ultimate goal for life is. If our ultimate goal is circumstantial happiness, then chances are very high that the negative, the hard stuff of life, it will make us bitter. We simply can't avoid all the things that steal away our happiness from us. And every time we get knocked around in life, that'll only reinforce how far the happiness goal that we've set for ourselves is out of reach. But if our goal for life is beyond this life, then our perspective will be different. Our perspective will go beyond the present life trials and the tribulations that we all face. And that doesn't mean that we can or we should try to ignore what's going on in life. No, we don't pretend that life is going well and is easy when life is not well and life is not going easy. But how we frame the events of life, it determines if we grow better and not bitter through adversity. Paul, the apostle, he's the writer of this letter to the Roman churches. He wrote those words that I just read for us. Paul was well acquainted with hardship and painful struggles. He lists his struggles in another letter, 2 Corinthians chapter 11. There he says he faced floggings and beatings. He faced many threats of being put to death. He said he faced natural disasters, exposure to the elements while being afloat in the sea or in the wilderness facing wild animals. He also faced many struggles that much of the world faces today: hunger, thirst, homelessness, false imprisonment. And yet through all that adversity, Paul grew better, not bitter. He could have been angry with God for allowing all that bad stuff to happen to him. But he did not get angry, or its companion, bitterness. And the reason Paul did not get bitter, but grew better, was that his perspective in life, it went beyond this short life that we live. Paul had an eternity-focused perspective and mindset. He had his heart set on something beyond this life. And that eternity-focused mindset, it was rooted in the salvation that he had from believing and trusting in the Lord Jesus Christ. His security for life rested in the eternal life that he knew was coming for him because God promised so. And he trusted that Jesus would provide him that eternal life to come. Proof that he had an eternal perspective and that his mindset rested in Jesus and what was to come, it comes in this bold statement that he made. He said, "To live is Christ, to die is gain." He lived this, his life, with the assurance that he belonged to the Lord Jesus. And he knew that when he would die, that he would go to be with his Savior and Lord Jesus. Paul's salvation in Jesus, that eternal mindset that he received from that, that's why he can say what he does in verses 3 and 4 of our passage. Excuse me. But we also rejoice in our sufferings because we know that suffering produces perseverance, perseverance, character, and character, hope. Paul says he and all Christians can rejoice in suffering. What a shocking statement for him to say and for us to hear. That goes against common thinking. It goes against what our society believes. But Paul writes these words not using common thinking. He writes these words not living by what society believes and says is true. No, his thinking is guided by God's wisdom and God's promises. Suffering, for the eternity-minded Christian, that does produce perseverance. That leads to improved character, that in turn leads to a hope that this world does not know. And that's because this hope is not in earthly things, but in what God has done in Jesus Christ and what God will yet do through Jesus. Backing up to the start of the passage, start of the chapter, Paul says Christians are justified through faith. To be justified is to be made right with God. And to be made right with God requires faith in Jesus Christ. Christian faith in Jesus, that is believing and trusting in what he has accomplished through his life here on earth. And during his life on earth, Jesus was crucified and died, and he was crucified and put to death as a payment for human sin. If you know the story, Easter comes. Jesus did not remain dead. He was resurrected from the dead. These are the works of Jesus, and these are the foundation of Christian faith. Paul goes on to talk about having peace with God. Believing and trusting in Jesus, that makes a person right with God. And being right with God is having peace with God. Because when our sin is taken away, then we're no longer enemies of God. We're no longer at war with him. When, through faith in Jesus, God takes away our sin, we become God's friends. Friends of God who are at peace with him. And that peace sets off the chain reaction of persevering, growing in character, and finding hope at all times in life. And that hope is really needed when life gets hard, when suffering and tribulation is upon us. God makes all this possible because he loves the people whom he saves. He saves the people that he loves by sending Jesus to live and to die in their place. When we recognize that Jesus is God's gift of love to us, that transforms our hearts. And it is God the Holy Spirit then who gives us that recognition of who Jesus is and be able to accept what Jesus has done on our behalf. God the Holy Spirit convinces us that Jesus has done all that's necessary to save us and to provide for us eternal life. What Paul tells us in these verses and explains more in the chapter and throughout the letter is how to become better and not bitter as we journey through life. Paul's not the only one who became better and not bitter through all his struggles and adversity. The person whose life we are here today to celebrate also grew better and not bitter through all her struggles. Effie persevered through many trials and much tribulation. Effie grew in character. She was refined as a person through her suffering. And Effie had hope, especially when, she faced many hardships. She lived her life this way, because she was a person of faith in Jesus Christ. She believed Jesus was her Savior from sin. She believed she was God's child because Jesus was her Savior. And she trusted that nothing in this life could take her out of God's love, could take that love away from her. She had assurance that one day she would go to be with her Lord and be with him for all eternity. Let me back up a little bit so we can reflect on the person God created and shaped Effie to be. Often when I think about what I'll say about someone at their funeral, I start by thinking of a word that might describe them. Sometimes that word jumps out pretty quick, other times not. With Effie, the word that came to mind, it jumped out to me right away, was perseverance. And the companion word to perseverance that also came to mind was determination. Effie certainly persevered through whatever challenges came her way in life. And she persevered with her chin up, as we say. Those of you who knew her for a long time and knew her well, you know of her struggles in life. Through it all, she persevered. She was a determined individual. She was that way because she was anchored to the Lord through prayer and Bible reading, as Crystal shared with us. Effie was a prayer warrior. Some of you have told me that her Bible was always out. You would often find her reading it, and Crystal confirmed that. She would pin Bible verses on her walls. She was grounded in the Lord and in his truth. That allowed her to persevere. She knew she was heading home to be with the Lord. And Effie's character, it was refined. Refined in the sense that precious metal is refined to be made pure. Effie had a heart of gold, we might say. No, she wasn't perfect. No one is. But for a little lady, her heart was huge for people. She loved you all with a love that I've rarely seen in people. She wanted the best for all of her family members. And I know she wanted you all to know Jesus like she knew him. Sorry if you feel I'm putting the pressure on. That's not my intent. My intent is to just tell you the truth. The truth about Effie and her faith, and the truth about the one in whom she had faith. And I know she wanted you all to know Jesus because she told me that's what she prayed for all the time. A person's true character is most often and most clearly revealed in the midst of suffering and trials. We could see that Effie's character was Christ-like as she endured all that she did in life. She grew better, not bitter. An amazing testament of her faith in the Lord Jesus. And Effie was a person of hope. Her hope was in what was to come after this life. Her hope was in the Lord who alone would provide her with eternal life. Her hope rested in God's promises that his people will live without sorrow, without tears, without pain, without struggle. And Effie's hope was not going to disappoint her because she trusted God to keep his promises. God has not broken any of the promises that he's made in his word, the Bible. There are a few more promises that God has yet to fulfill. This will happen when the Lord Jesus returns. But my point is that the Lord God, he is 100% trustworthy. He has given zero reason to doubt him or his word. Effie knew and believed this about God. And as a result, she had a hope that could not be broken. Nothing could take away Effie's hope for what was to come. And that's because her hope rested in the ever-faithful, ever-true, and ever-loving God. We too can know this ever faithful, ever true, ever loving God by getting to know Jesus. Jesus is God the Son, who became like us in every way. We can relate to Jesus, which is in part why he came to earth. Jesus came so that we can all get to know him, so that we can see God's love through him. Jesus came so that we can have life now and for eternity. Effie believed this about the Lord Jesus. Her life was a testament to the amazing, transforming power that faith in Jesus provides. Her life rested upon the salvation in Jesus that Paul explains in these five verses and will continue to do so throughout the book of Romans. Effie's salvation in Jesus, it provided her with benefits to life, this life. Benefits and gifts like peace with God, a permanent standing in God's grace, hope for future glory, assurance of God's love, the certainty of deliverance, and joy that comes from knowing God. These are the gifts that Effie held on to. And these gifts are available for all of us if we put our hope and our trust in the Lord Jesus. Effie was a gift to your family. She was a gift to you from God. She was a wonderful role model for her family and for everyone who knew her. And today we thank the Lord for her life. And we thank the Lord for her testimony of a life trusting the Savior, trusting in Jesus. Almighty God, we thank you for Effie. We thank you for the many years that you blessed her with here on earth. We thank you for the many years of being with her family. She could play such a pivotal role in her family's lives, Lord. We thank you for the role model that she was to them and to those in her community. We thank you, Lord, that she lived out her faith. We thank you that she accepted the gifts of your faith, of faith in Jesus. She had peace with you, Lord God. She knew that she stood in your amazing grace. We could see in her hope for the future. We could see in her an assurance that you loved her, would never let her go. We could see in her the certainty that one day she would be delivered of her sin and all the effects of sin, her broken body, her fading mind. And we thank you, Lord, that through it all she showed joy, joy that comes from knowing you. Lord, as we remember her, not only today, but in the days ahead, we pray that she may stand as an example for her family, for all of us, Lord, of what comes from having faith in Jesus that allows us to live this life facing whatever adversity, whatever struggles and tribulations come our way. May our hope rest in Jesus. May our eyes be fixed on him like it was for Effie. We pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. A moment we'll stand together and we'll sing familiar words of Amazing Grace.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved.
Here in our church, our Reformed church, we often throughout the year say this profession of faith, this confession of faith, question and answer one of the Heidelberg Catechism. If you know it and you're comfortable saying it out loud, please join in when we read the answer together. I'll read the question. What is your only comfort in life and in death? That I am not my own, but belong, body and soul, in life and in death, to my faithful Savior, Jesus Christ. He has fully paid for all my sins with his precious blood and has set me free from the tyranny of the devil. He also watches over me in such a way that not a hair can fall from my head without the will of my Father in heaven. In fact, all things must work together for my salvation. Because I belong to him, Christ, by his Holy Spirit, assures me of eternal life and makes me wholeheartedly willing and ready from now on to live for him. One final passage from Scripture, Revelation 22. Then the angel showed me the river of the water of life, as clear as crystal, flowing from the throne of God and of the Lamb, down the middle of the great street of the city. On each side of the river stood the tree of life, bearing 12 crops of fruit, yielding its fruit every month. And the leaves of the tree are for the healing of the nations. No longer will there be any curse. The throne of God and of the Lamb will be in the city, and his servants will serve him. They will see his face, and his name will be on their foreheads. There will be no more night. They will not need the light of a lamp or the light of the sun. For the Lord God will give them light, and they will reign forever and ever. Effie is experiencing this in part, I'm sure. We don't know, of course, exactly what it is. We pass on and go be with the Lord, but she is in his glory. We praise the Lord for that. You can remain seated as we sing By the Sea of Crystal. Lead you in prayer once more. God of all grace, you sent your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, to bring life and immortality into this world. We give you thanks that by his death he destroyed the grip of death, and that through his resurrection he has opened now the kingdom of God to all believers. Make us confident that because he lives, we may also live eternally with him. Lord, I pray, deepen our conviction that neither death nor life, nor things present or things to come, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from your life shown most clearly in the Lord Jesus Christ. Immerse us now in that love, we pray, which is found in faith in Jesus, the Lord God. Embrace in your love all of us as we go forth from this place. I pray, be especially close to Effie's family as they now go to lay her body to rest. In your name, Lord God, I pray. Amen. After the service, as I mentioned, the family will be going to the cemetery to lay Effie's body to rest. You're encouraged to remain here, enjoy coffee. It won't be too long. I invite you to stand now to receive a parting benediction, and we sing our closing song, "Ad is a God, Glory to God," which we'll sing one time through. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn his face toward you and give you his everlasting peace.